Hey guys, it's Pineapple, and in this video, we'll be going over everything there is to know about Nine and his group, since they're the villains of My Hero Academia Heroes Rising. This video is for any of you who want to know all about these guys because you can't watch the movie or it isn't available in your area, or you just watched the movie and you want to remember all the details about them that you saw in the movie. So let's go into detail about who they are and what they can do. I want to remind you guys you can follow me on Twitter at VocalPineapple, or just like this video, subscribe, and hit that bell icon to join my league of notifications. You can also click join now to join the Pineapple Hero Agency by contributing a small amount to the channel every month to get new content on the channel and access to custom badges and emojis. I made a list of emojis and sent them to an artist, and I already got some of them back, and they're just, at the very least, expect to see those soon. With that said, let's get to talking about Nine and his crew, as well as their fates in the movie, after that intro. Going on with Nine in the beginning of My Hero Academia Heroes Rising. Well, before we get to that, I want to remind you that there are actually two Japan-exclusive manga chapters that revolve around Nine's past a bit that you might not have heard of. I have videos on both of those, where I even do some voice acting, to tell the story of how Deku and Bakugo actually met Nine at an earlier point in their lives, and there's another video about a chapter detailing just how Nine came to work with the League of Villains and the evil Dr. Kyudai Garaki. Once you've watched those, this video will really give you the full experience, so I suggest you do. For those of you that have, though, or just don't care, let's get started. At the very beginning of the film, Nine is being transported by the League of Villains. If you recall, at the end of the My Villain Academia arc, the Doctor tells Shigaraki that he's ready to give him the power that he desires, but he needs him to do one last thing for him. In this movie, we find out that the League members are told to transport Nine and get him from point A to point B, but they weren't allowed to know anything about him at all. Even Shigaraki, the new leader of the Liberation Army and one who's gained the Doctor's assistant, isn't allowed to know the truth about Nine's ambitions and ideals. We'll get into why this is the case later, but it definitely has a lot to do with what Nine's plans are and how he plans on going about them. The villains are attacked by heroes, and eventually Endeavor wipes out their convoy, but Nine escapes and regroups with his team of three quirk users. Now, Nine underwent a procedure to implant All For One's quirk factor into him, but Nine already sort of had a natural weakness to his body before coming to the Doctor. This is probably what limits the amount of quirks that he can steal with All For One, but we'll get to that a bit later in the video. Nine explains that his procedure was successful, and his companions are pretty excited about this, because they think that their new world is finally approaching. These three are actually great villains when you compare them to what we had in the first movie, and I actually want to spend some time focusing on them and breaking them down as well. So let's do that now, since we are talking about how they first reconnect with Nine in the beginning of the movie. First off, we have Hoyo Makihara, also known as the wrapped-up villain, Mummy. We don't know much about this guy besides the fact that he has a really cool design and a great quirk. Mummy is a gray-haired young man, covered in red bandages and wearing military vests and gear, sort of like a ninja, actually. His quirk, Mummification, lets him control anything that he completely covers in his cloths. This quirk doesn't allow him to control flesh or a human body, but he can control a person's clothes or anything that's on their body, which effectively lets him control the person, I guess. I guess Mirio would be the perfect counter against Mummy, because even without his quirk, if he ran around naked and just punched him a bunch, I'm sure Mummy would have a lot of trouble. Now, when he wraps something in his cloths, it doesn't just become something that he can move around with his mummy wraps. The covered objects actually come to life to a certain extent. This means that if Mummy covers a truck in his bandages, that truck will grow arms and legs and a big evil red eye, sort of like those mummy clowns that you might remember from Soul Eater. He's rather formidable since he takes on a number of UA students at the same time, and he even gives Bakugo some trouble at first. In the prequel manga chapters, we see Mummy looking like he's downtown in the local Tokyo club scene, having trouble with people picking fights for him for whatever reason. It could be the opposite though, and he could have been the aggressor in these instances, running into the downtown to fight and beat up everyone that he could to prove that he's the strongest, because that definitely fits in line with what Nine would want from a follower. We also have Kyudaka Hasaki, the My Hero Academia character most obviously influenced by a marble and human, in this case, Medusa. Slice is a petite woman in a purple dress with a light purple blouse below. She has long, beautiful red hair and wears a Bakugo-style face mask over her eyes. She also has bladed attachments that she can add to her gloves to add to her combat ability, but to be honest, all she really needs to be deadly is her hair. Her quirk allows her to freely control her hair and even shoot it out as dangerous projectiles. These strands of hair have to be very dense and packed of energy because she shoots waves of them at boats and they all explode, and she even destroys solid cave stone and pierces flesh and dark shadow rather easily. Not only can she shoot her hair out in halo-style needler needles, but she can also complete completely harden her hair into different shapes like blades. This actually makes her hair kind of resemble Hela's helmet in Thor Ragnarok, which I thought was another cool parallel, if not a purely accidental one. Sly seems the most concerned about Nine when his weakness presents itself, and she's extremely devout. While the other two are obviously the muscle, Sly seems to be Nine's number two more than any of the others, and she even comes to his aid several times in the movie, saying that she won't allow anyone to get in his way. In her prequel manga section, we see her sitting in a nightgown near her bed in a completely destroyed room. It looks like everything just fell apart around her because she didn't care to take care of any of it, but maybe even her own outbursts are responsible for the state of things. Either way, she just lays there in a disgusting mess with an absolutely empty expression, but the one thing that's perfect is her hair. She was just waiting for a purpose, for something to fight for. Without that purpose, she lived an empty existence, so I guess it's good for her that Nine finally gave her one. Finally, we have easily the most impressive of the three side villains in this movie, and that is Chojuro Kon, otherwise known as Top 5 Beast, Chimera. Chimera, at first glance, is a very tall dog human, reminiscent of some other amazing dog humans in anime, like Rex, but there's way more going on under the surface here, and that's why his name isn't just Big Wolf or Rapide Senior for a reason. He's more than just a wolf. He wears a gray vest, dark pants, and a large tan jacket, but once you start looking at him closely, you might notice things like his more bird-like taloned hands or his large reptilian tail. Chimera's quirk gives him the body of multiple creatures all put together, and he even seems to get some pretty exaggerated effects because of the combination of animals and creatures. You can assume that he can do anything that an animal can do and take it to its highest point, which is why Chimera can shoot out fire blasts from his mouth, and even why his strength was so amazing. This guy was truly terrifying, and I might just make a video about him specifically because he's one of the shining lights of this already great movie. I would have loved to see Chimera go up against Deku at some point because he was just doing some things that almost felt one for all worthy. At one point, Shoto shoots a fire blast at him, and Chimera just puts his arms in front of him and raises them up quickly, causing a wall of air to shoot up and deflect Shoto's fire completely. He constantly bursts out of Shoto's ice, and he even goes hand to hand with all of the hand to hand specialists in the class, like Sato and Ojuro. His strength was no joke, since he was literally throwing large boulders and sending characters flying with really impactful punches. But the true terror comes out of Chimera when he gets serious and unleashes his transformed state. Horikoshi really is a fan of One Piece, you can tell, and it shows here in the way that Chimera's power kinda operates like a Zoan fruit user, having partial and fully transformed states. When he's at full power, Chimera almost triples in size, and his arms protrude large feathers, with his feet and hands turning into massive hawk-like talons, and his muscle mass increasing all over. His fire blasts become straight up hyper beams, and he easily decimates the forest around him, and almost melts Kirishima from what we get to see, so this man was definitely a major threat. His recruitment into Nine's group is the one that we actually do get to see in the movie. In the prequel chapters, we see Chimera running through an alleyway and knocking a garbage can over, obviously running from heroes. In the movie, we see that Nine actually rescues Chimera from heroes that were surrounding him and trying to capture him because Nine felt that Chimera was strong. The world deemed him a monster because of his quirk and persecuted him, giving him a much harder life, when really, if things were just about power, Chimera would be able to rule over all those people who rule over him instead. Nine believes that a true superhuman society should be run by the powerful. It's very much the viewpoint that the Homelander has in the Boys comic. Nine can control the sky, but he lives crawling on the ground, with his head under the boot of society. We see pieces of his tragic backstory in the prequel comics, but we can assume his parents died, and there definitely is some bloodshed in his early childhood that he shouldn't have been exposed to. The young boy wandered, homeless and powerless on the streets, but was he really ever powerless? He had the power to summon massive storms, to peel cities from their foundations, and tear open rifts of dark clouds and storms in the skies. He could call down lightning to kill anyone he wanted to, or summon hurricane force winds and typhoons to send anyone who opposed him to the middle of the ocean far away from the battle. He was horrifying, but there was a beacon of hope for the heroes. Nine has a massive weakness. Yes, his quirk is insanely powerful, but Nine actually faces cell decay and degeneration after using his quirk a certain amount of times. This pretty much equals up to him having the Itachi disease, where a character is born almost all powerful, but of course has some sort of sickness that makes them randomly cough up blood and slowly start to die. So since he's dying from using his quirk, and he wants to create a world where his friends can exist as the powerful elite at the top of the food chain, Nine realizes that something has to give. And if it needs to be him giving himself to the League for experimenting, then that's what it needs to be. His team doesn't actually agree with him going to the League for this surgery, but none of that really matters to Nine. This is the only way that he can make that shared reality real. Through a process, Nine gains All for One from Dr. Garaki. This is of course because the Doctor can copy quirks, but not all quirks are compatible with all people. So Nine being compatible with All for One's quirk is actually a miracle of sorts. As much of a miracle as it is, there's still a catch to Nine offering himself up to the League. His cell decay has actually gotten much worse, and if he overuses his quirk too much, he'll straight up just begin to die outright. But Nine doesn't care about this trade-off. He's given a suit by the Doctor to hold back his power and stabilize his body enough for him to find a solution on his own and grow past needing the suit. And Nine very quickly thinks of the perfect solution to this problem. If his problem is that his cells are degenerating and decaying, then all he has to do is steal a cell activating quirk, which is simple now that he has a version of All for One that lets him steal 8 quirks. Nine steals a quirk that he believes is going to heal him, and tragically that quirk belongs to the father of Katsuma and Mahoro, the two kids that need to be protected in this movie. The quirk is cell activation, but it only works on type A blood, and he has type B. Because of this, he wants to steal Katsuma's quirk, since quirks are hereditary and Katsuma's cell activation quirk should be better than his father's, since quirks improve the more that they're passed down. We actually know this to be true, since Katsuma's quirk is actually rather amazing. He'd be able to heal his body and break his dependence on the League, but he'd also be free of his disease and have much more power than he already has. So Nine heads to the island to steal the quirk and comes up against the heroes, but with his multiple quirks, of course he's gonna be a massive problem for them. Let's explain what each of Nine's quirks are, since we keep talking about him getting All for One but being limited, and obviously we have to discuss that before we get to talking about how broken he is. First off, we have his original quirk, Weather Control. Like we've explained already in this video, his quirk allows him to control the power of amazing storms and everything having to do with storms, like controlling clouds, rain, lightning, wind, and thunder. His second quirk is, of course, All for One, given to him by Dr. Kyudai Garaki. This allows him to steal someone's quirk and also hold multiple quirks at once. Like we've said, he can steal 8 quirks, but use 9 overall, including his original quirk and All for One. Now, I've seen some sites and other people list his quirk identifying vision as another one of his quirks, but I honestly think that this is part of All for One itself, so I'm not going to be listing this as a separate quirk. My reasoning behind this is that 9 can only hold 9 quirks if you say quirk vision is one of them, meaning he only has room for Katsuma's quirk to add to his pile of 9 quirks. But we know that this can't be the case because he tried to steal Deku's quirk early in the movie, and even though that failed because 9 couldn't take all 7 of the quirks that Deku has, that still means that 9 had at least one free slot besides the slot he was saving for Katsuma's quirk to save for another quirk that he can steal if he found a good one. The third quirk that we know that he has is one that we see him steal in the movie, and that's the cell activation for type A blood quirk. This quirk would let 9 basically force his cells to replicate and heal, completely countering the negative effects of his cell degeneration. The issue is 9 has a different blood type, so this quirk is completely useless to him. He can still use it to possibly heal and power up his friends, but again, it's at least useless for him as far as his goals are concerned. The fourth quirk that we know that 9 has, because he uses it so often in the film, is his amazing shield quirk. Nine can create a barrier of air that is amazingly durable, and he can even create more than one shield at a time, allowing for him to hide behind an extremely durable and layered defense. Not only can he do massive island-sized barriers, but he can also create smaller and much more dense and compact ones that even have darker associated colors to really show you just how dense that shield energy is being packed. Nine doesn't just have to hold the shield in front of his hands though, because he can also completely surround himself in a shield bubble and then push the shield outward in every direction. His fifth quirk is a quirk that lets him shoot pink laser beams out of his fingertips. These lasers pierce in the flesh, and they're actually very reminiscent of Frieza's death beam, with us even getting a shot of Nine pointing death beam style at Sero with a deadly look on his face. He can use this energy that comes from his fingers as lashing ropes of energy, so it's not just limited to quick shots. He can sustain the beams and control them with his hand movements, and when he's at full power, it seems like the beams are far more physical and real looking, if that makes any sense. Quirk number six 6 for 9 is similar to Tokoyami's Dark Shadow. This quirk allows 9 to summon large dark blue Chinese dragon-like familiars from his back. These things are extremely durable, and he can even use them Doc Ock style to climb up surfaces if he wishes to. They have mouths that can bite down on things and tighten their grip on 9's command, and he can even create multiple heads and split heads apart at a moment's notice, so it's sort of like this is a Hydra summoning quirk, which is amazing. Number 7 and the last quirk that 9 actually has is a quirk that allows him to control the air to create Blast of Pressure. He uses this a few times to send Bakugo and Deku both flying onto their backs, and it really is good when used in combination with his shield quirk, since he can block and blow an enemy away with his air blast immediately, or trap an enemy between the ground and his shield and blast them with tons of force, doing loads of damage. Like I've said already, I think 9 was prepared to take One For All from Deku and make that his 8th quirk, but he wasn't able to do that because he's limited to having 9 quirks total, and One For All technically has the quirks of the different users inside of it as well. If 9 wanted to though, I'm sure he could have decided to take Bakugo's quirk instead, but he never really has a chance since the process takes some time, and every time he's around Bakugo, it's because he's in the middle of a battle. Lastly, the 9th quirk that 9 wanted, of course, is Katsuma's improved cell activation quirk. This quirk, like we've said, greatly enhances someone's performance, but it also heals them and inhibits further improved cell regeneration upon activation that can even be applied to the user himself. This would have been a game changer for 9, and maybe with this he might have even been able to break past his 9 quirk limit. So with an understanding of everything that he can do, let me tell you, he is so much more powerful than the sum of his parts. All of those things together sound dangerous, but the level at which 9 can use all of those quirks, especially together, is exactly what makes him so terrifying. When he finally lets loose at the end of the movie and just gives up everything for the sake of finally reaching the goal right in front of him, his power is truly terrifying, with him being obviously able to destroy the entirety of Naboo Island. At one point, it seemed like he was gonna erase the smaller island with a single lightning bolt, but even the main island began to tear apart and become part of the massive storm that he created, with tornadoes spawning all over the main island and causing mass destruction in his wake. In the movie, we get a glimpse of 9's perfect world, the one that he wants to create, and all we see is destruction all over the world. We see people in rubble and wreckage just floating amongst destroyed buildings. 9 wants true anarchy and chaos. If he has to spend the rest of his life fighting others and destroying everything to prove that he's the strongest and secure his place in the world, he will. And it's all because 9 feels like from the very start, he has been excluded and pushed aside. He was born with all of this power, but his life amounted to nothing. He was a wandering, homeless young man with no one to cherish, no one to love, and no real goals to cling to. The world felt unfair to him, so he decided that the world needed to change, and he realized that he had the power to bring about that change. He, who the world casted aside. All he needed to do was heal himself, and that would all be possible. He would create a new world and even become the new All For One of sorts, ruling the world as he sees fit. When you think about it, he's actually very similar to Shigaraki in a lot of ways, as far as his goals go. And next up, or at least very soon, I'll have a video going way deeper into their parallels, because I think there are definitely some hints for the story moving forward that we can mine from our time with 9 in this movie. That kind of rhymed. To know what really happens to him and his team at the end of the movie, go support Horikoshi and watch the movie for yourself. Get that theater experience while you can, and catch Heroes Rising in theaters right now. With that said, that's everything there is to know about 9 and his crew. I hope this has been helpful. Love you guys, it's Pineapple, and shout out to the new members of the Pineapple Hero Agency. I got drafts for all the new emojis I'm going to be adding to the channel, so soon Jesse Willis, Lil Bobby 72, Charlie31198, and Anime Lover Nicole are going to join the other members of the Pineapple Hero Agency by getting access to all those cool emojis and extra bonus content. So click join and find a tier that works for you. I love you guys, peace and welcome.